Monty Chatter, the promoter of Wave Group, was arrested from Delhi airport last night by the Economic Affairs Wing of Delhi Police in connection with the cheating case and making false promises of giving cheap flats to buyers. The Chandra brothers of Unitech have been in jail, so are Amrapali directors. And there's an arrest warrant out for Pranav and Sushil Ansal of Ansal API. Now, these are just some of the high-profile builders whose names have hit the headlines. Reliable sources from both industry bodies, NASSCOM and CREDAI, have confirmed to us that the number of builders arrested, in jail and out on bail has crossed 150 across India. What's even more frightening is that despite arrest, none of the stuck projects have any visibility of completion. In fact, proprietary data over the last one quarter shows that the number of delayed projects with no site of completion across India have increased from 1389 to 1473. Units stuck have gone up to 4.52 lakh units from 4.2 lakh units, crossing a total value of 3 lakh crore rupees. How much more pain lies ahead of the industry and home buyers, and how much more will this housing crisis deepen? Joining me today on Urban Reality, Abhay Upadhyay, President, Forum for People's Collective Efforts, Vivek Kohli, Senior Partner and Co-founder, ZS Law Associates. We also have with us Aditya Gudgutia. He's a home buyer of JP Infratech. Vivek Tyagi, President, Unitech Anthea Home Buyers Association. And we also have from Bangalore, one of the safest markets considered, Sunil Oswald, who's a stuck home buyer from Mantri Web City Project. Well, we are going to focus today's conversation on three pillars. What can the courts do? What can RERA do? And what can the government do if these people need to get back their homes? Let me start with you, Vivek, because I think your fight started. Yeah. Longest back, both the brothers are in jail, yet there's no sight of your homes.
Yeah, no sight of homes, but still, I mean, hope is there. Very high hopes are there right now.
All right, let's start with the courts. What do you want the court to do?
We want court to recognize three things. Number one, first culprit is license issuing authorities like DTCP Haryana and Noida Authority.
Okay.
They issued the license to builders without charging EDC, IDC charges. Just after issuing the license, 2 months only, they changed the status of projects from approved to non-approved. But still, they did not issue any public notice in the newspapers that, listen, guys, these projects are not approved.
Okay.
Don't get into this trap.
So, look at approving authorities.
First culprits are state governments, license issuing authorities like DTCP Haryana and Noida Authority. Court should recognize this fact, number one. Mm-hmm. Number two, banks. They are the biggest culprit. They are the huge beneficiary of this scam. They financed all the unapproved projects and they earn huge money out of those EMIs. They are still earning that money. But nobody is recognizing this fact that actually these banks are the main culprits, mm-hmm. along with builders.
All right.
Builders, of course, they were allowed to collect money against unapproved projects. They did that, but not alone.
But why did banks allow that?
Yes, absolutely.
Happen?
Absolutely.
How did they allow lending or loans to home buyers on an unapproved
absolutely.
Project?
Absolutely.
Very important point.
Where is the RBI?
Where's RBI?
All the banks, they are governed, they are regulated by RBI. And RBI is nowhere in picture.
Number three, what should courts recognize, which they haven't in the Unitech case? Anything else, or these two are the most important points?
Three things. Number third one is that, you know, all these builders, they have siphoned off all the money. Mm-hmm. Money is reflecting in their balance sheet, lying in 32 shell companies, like I'm talking about Unitech especially right now. In 32 shell companies, money is reflecting. 4,500 crores are lying in 32 shell companies in Cyprus and India. But nobody is talking about that money, why that money is not being recovered.
All right. Let me come to JP. You're staring now at a possible liquidation because bank, your favorite people in this transaction, IDBI has decided that it does not want NBCC bid to go through. What is your plea to NCLT, which is also part of our judicial system, and to maybe Supreme Court?
So I think between the courts, whether it's NCLT, the quasi-judicial body, or the Supreme Court, one has to recognize what Vivek is saying is absolutely right. Banks are the biggest culprit in the entire scheme of things. I think there has been a repeated case of evergreening which has happened. We've been running through from pillar to post for last 2 years. There have been three resolutions which have been put to vote so far. The banks have voted against all three resolutions. Home buyers have voted in favor of all three resolutions. Mm-hmm. Home buyers suo moto insisted that there should be a forensic audit. Banks voted against that also, making that resolution also fail. So why is that hesitation in the banks to go after the real culprit, which is the Manoj Gaur? Is there something which they are also hand in glove with, because of which they don't want to go after the real target and find out the money which has been siphoned? Supreme Court set aside 750 crores. The banks and JP are not even allowing that 750 crores to be used for construction. So I think even if, while the process is on for last 2 years, 1 year, we can at least get that
interim. You could have used the 750 crores for construction.
Absolutely.
What went on? All right, let me bring in Sunil from Bangalore. Sunil, I mean, you come from a city where actually real estate is considered to be one of the safest real estate, yet you're stuck in a project with a builder who's currently advertising new projects. So first, what's your plea to the courts? What should they be recognizing in your case?
Yes, Manisha. So, you know, courts can definitely do a lot. We have one example in Bangalore, very, you know, known builder by Skyline, and the CCB, the City Crime Branch, arrested the builder, and they set up a mediation, and their project, you know, is on right track for delivery. Similarly, you know, police, if they want, they could mediate and, you know, get the results. Of course, civil courts take a lot of time. That's where, you know, every buyer was looking forward for, you know, RERA court. Whereas RERA is giving the orders, but builders are not even, you know, caring about, you know, what to implement the orders given by the RERA. So that's why people are slowly losing hope on RERA. Otherwise, RERA is a great act, wherein, you know, solution is also under
what,
the same.
What has Karnataka RERA said about your
RERA
project? What has you've been stuck in Mantri Web City? What has been Karnataka RERA's observations or ruling on any of the cases you filed?
Yes, so there are you know, tens of cases filed in RERA against Mantri developers, and they have also given positive orders, but, you know, the promoter is not honoring those orders and challenging them in a higher court. And this is giving little setback to the buyers, because they are not having seeing a hope.
All right.
And construction is also going on a slow pace, wherein it gives a feeling that they don't care for, you know, this new regulatory act.
So, really, you've really come to the crux of the matter. Developers, do they really care for the new regulatory act? Abhay Upadhyay, your voice here. I mean, courts and now RERA. Buyers swinging from one to the other. Some buyers still have hope that RERA courts might be a better option than actually going to civil and Supreme Court.
Well, Manisha, I think now we have come to a stage, as you really mentioned in the beginning, that even stuck projects and has gone up, the number of stuck projects has gone up, and delivery is not being given. So I think government has to take a comprehensive, you know, solution for this problem, which is now lingering for last so many years.
Abhay, I'm
going
to come to the government a little bit later.
You know,
I want
even
to know
their order with
what
regard
do we do
to either
with RERA
first. Is not being executed. Yeah. So RERA also we need to sit down and see, because RERA is orders with regard to possession or with regard to refund are not getting executed. Even in matter of possession, you know, if you see the Karnataka RERA, there are more than 800 projects for which registration is expired. So the thing is, if the authorities are not monitoring, you have already given timeline from which was supposed to be completed in 2016. Now you have given 2020, and then again 20, it is also not complete, and you are asking for extension. And, you know, RERA is just giving extension without hefty penalty, without checking what was the reason why they have not completed. So at that, you know, you need to work for it. So with now you see RERA has happened in Gurugram, you know, there's no judicial officer, and that is why the entire Gurugram working is now affected. Similarly, if you see with regard to fund, we know there's a biggest problem in real estate industry, diversion of fund. So what is RERA authorities doing? Whether they are checking that 70% money is being deposited in their separate account? If not, what action is being taken? So you see, RERA authorities have to be proactive. And with regard to other judicial forum, Manisha, I'm sure you will appreciate this. You know, National Consumer Forum is giving date from 11 months to 12 months. If one date, you know, builder is coming and taking date, that means straight away I am being given next date after 11 months. So if that be the case, then how can you expect a consumer to go to approach court? So judiciary also, you know, the government has to see from all angles whether it is judiciary.
All right. Let me come back to you, Abhay. Let me get Vivek in.
Even RERA
I will come back to you,
Abhay.
Vivek, Here's a situation where an Amrapali family has gone into a flat in a building which is not fully ready, does not have occupation certificate. That is the level of stress amongst home buyers today. They're willing to risk their life because they have no other option. And you've heard all the participants here. I'm only going to focus on the judiciary and RERA together. What do we do? It's seeming like a no-go and completely frustrating situation. Builders don't want to follow RERA orders.
So Manisha, it's interesting, but you know, you have to figure this out, that if you go out to the court or you go to the RERA authority, then effectively you're asking for the RERA authority how to regulate the project and to make sure that during the life cycle of the project is initiated and completed on time, money is properly handled. So that's the role of the RERA, in which I'm sure the RERA will, as it, you know, grows out of its teething troubles, it'll do that. If you go to the courts, you're basically asking for accountability. That if anything went wrong, whether it was a promoter, whether it was the authorities, whether it was the banks, fix accountability, and then the consequences, whether civil or criminal in nature, should follow. That part is all fine. Here's my counter question. What is the priority? The priority is to fix responsibility, or okay, the priority is to make sure that a completed home with an occupation certificate, which is a safe habitat, should be provided to the family which paid the money.
Your number of stuck projects has gone up.
That's because the government is not taking any action at all. So, you know, you can go for the regulation, which is the RERA authority, and to make sure that the project is run properly, and which I'm sure will happen in the future. But these are projects which are all with some legacy history prior to RERA coming into force. Or you can go to courts to fix accountability.
Vivek, I'm going to toss a very, very interesting question. CREDAI has spoken about it as well. These are not earlier projects. Now there is a danger of current projects becoming delinquent because of the NBFC liquidity crisis. You know, there have been cases where if the builder has not paid his installment or interest installment, the money which the buyers have deposited and has gone into the escrow account has been swept out by the NBFC. What are we staring at? How can NBFCs take the money which is in the escrow account for completion of the project? And this has happened, we know, in April. And we don't know what is going to happen now at the end of June.
So servicing the interest and the loan that you take is part of the 70%. So to that extent, the NBFCs are within the law when they actually sweep that account. The difficulty is unsold inventory. In today's market, where, you know, the consumer confidence is absolutely at the bottom, where nobody is actually willing to pay for an under construction project. Everybody is willing to pay, give me the key, I'll take a home loan, give me the key and I'll occupy the flat, or I'll rent it out, whatever I'll do. But I want the key against my money. I'm not getting into an under construction project because that's a confidence issue. Now, you know, for a project to start in today's time...
No builder is willing to come in and say that I will take an under construction project because he has multiple cases which are going to...
Exactly.
That legal responsibility, RERA responsibility, what these buyers want is humongous. We're going to keep this conversation going. The most important missing piece of what we've discussed so far is, what about the government? I mean, all of last 5 years, we heard this big rhetoric. We've got RERA. You're going to get your homes. You will not face any more challenges. Again, I'm going to read out this data. April, there were 1389 projects which were stuck. In June, this number has gone up to 1473. From 2.4 lakh homebuyers stuck, the number has gone up to 2.71 lakh. What's going on? We'll come back and talk a little bit more.